Hey guys, what's going on? Video you were about to watch will be part two, probably a four-part video series. This video will highlight Minocan Farms up at Bismarck, North Dakota. It was an absolute blast. Look forward to going back again one of these days, so hope you enjoy.
Is that what happened? Is that what's going on with sweet potatoes?
Yeah,
they got dinged?
They probably got a little whiff because the door is open and I think it drifted in here. And she didn't cut these off, but you can see that curl. These are curled too. But we did cut the tomatoes off.
Are these special tomatoes?
There's some different heirloom ones in there. I don't know what all she's got. I think there's some purple Cherokee and some others. I'm not sure.
Exactly.
Do you see them?
The ratio with carbon and nitrogen and potassium.
And ultimately, the leachate then goes to the drain of the pad, and then they do an insulated compost right up to the end, because if you're going to be in the anaerobic area, it'll be there. That's kind of a spot. So when you end it earlier, and then you got a foot of alfalfa. So the juice goes through that foot of alfalfa and it kind of cleans up a little bit and empties into the drain. And then Daryl went down to the Cenex station south of town here at Hazleton and got an insulated livestock tank. So it's no different than any of the ranches in Burley County would use. And so it's something you can bury. And then when we went to use it, we put a submersible in this end. So we got that end's just a touch lower, but we pump out of the higher end, okay, just because. Okay.
Yeah, we haven't finished the project yet. So
there's no odor. If you want to put your nose in there, you can, but you really don't smell.
If it was smelling, I'd already.
You'd know it.
I'd know it already.
You would know it right away. Yeah, it's easy to tell if something's bad. The key to it, anything like this, is has to be aerobic. If it goes anaerobic, that's an issue. You're doing something wrong. You don't want it. Spill it. Get rid of that.
How do you keep it aerobic?
So the old adage that if it smells, it's working. It's wrong.
It's working all right, Ray.
that
would be your tip. Yeah, that would be your tip. Because when you take some out, like sometimes I'll, or we have pails over there on the little ones, you just put your face up there and you smell it. You smell virtually nothing.
In the sea trench. Oh, and then the foliar was twice. The plant sap analysis came back. This is the talk for the cornfield, by the way. Thank you for that. The plant sap analysis came back and it said basically phosphorus is pretty good. Okay, we figured that because we've seen fairly good phosphorus levels when you bring in cover crops and diversity, plant diversity. So I wasn't too surprised by that, but the plant sap said, okay, your nitrogen's low. Well, again, not too surprised because we're decomposing a big cover crop. I mean, we had a pretty strong cover there. We were really aggressive with it, maybe too aggressive, but it's okay for us to fail on a 12-acre field. I don't want my neighbor to fail on a 12,000-acre farm. So you're looking at that scenario there, and you're saying to yourself, okay, let's add the two foliars. So the two foliars added, I think it was 28 units of N to gather. Okay, the two to gather. And the math isn't easy with fish emulsion concentrate. So I did the math, and then I contacted the smartest person I know, our soil scientist, Mark Liebig, over at ARS, you know, he's got a high IQ, and I sent him, I built him up really good on the email, and I said, Mark, you're the smartest guy I know, blah, blah, blah. Yeah. You know? And then I said, here's my math, take a look at it, and let me know. I'll do it without looking at your math, and we'll see what we come up with. So he did it, and we had the same answer. So then I breathed a huge sigh of relief, because you know you're really showing your cards to everybody, right? Can you do that? Here's my map. And so about 28 units of N, about 14 each, and about a pound of phosphorus. And so we just did the last sap. Where's Jaden and Seth? We
Tuesday.
Did the last sap when?
Yesterday.
So we did the last sap yesterday. It'd be interesting to see that one. We use New Age. First year doing sap analysis, don't claim to know everything about it.
But you're saying it's not that those measurements aren't in this, that's just what the leaf tissue is showing.
That's the leaf tissue.
The response.
This goes to the
response.
Molecular research, right. DNA lab, if you want to know what's in this. Okay. So I got the samples in the fridge now, we'll be shipping those.
And when you're doing the foliar, are you diluting this with,
no.
It's just straight?
No.
Okay.
You could dilute it.
Okay.
And your 4 gallons, that's in slice? Or 4 gallons total?
That's it.
In slice.
And it's straight this? Straight.
Yep. 4 gallons straight. Yes.
Okay.
In the furrow.
Okay. 8 gallons each foliar.
This is the first year you're doing sap analysis.
Yeah.
What did you do last year?
We didn't do sap.
No tissue,
year.
But no tissue analysis?
We did tissue, yes.
Are you still doing
regular
tissue? To compare apples
we,
to apples?
We were thinking maybe tissue at the end again. We'll see.
Okay. I'm just curious how that corresponds, because a lot of guys are going different directions, and I think there's a pretty good middle way.
Yeah. You find your way. I think Ray Ward would agree that, you know, the biggest thing is, can you trust that lab? You know, think about it.
Some
sketchy people, can you trust them?
Same thing as the soil health tests, when they are not calibrated. And the sap tests are not calibrated.
It's a shot in.
Okay, so we just got done looking at the worm pit. Their vermicompost extract. Over here checking out their outdoor garden. I can tell you right now, we don't have enough time today to get to see everything that they got going on here at Minocan Farm. It is very cool. They got a lot of different things going on. This is definitely going to be have to come back, check out what's going on here, because this is just very, very cool.
From the east, that's called the Red River Valley, and it's basically a big, huge glacial lake.
Okay, so we're out here in one of their fields, and I'm assuming this is just a perennial break that they got out here. But they got alfalfa, he said some metal brome, crested wheat, western wheat, I think, and a couple of different other forms. And they've obviously grazed it already over here. Lay down a lot of litter, and it shows. If you look at the soil, it shows. Beautiful.
So we're going to get into it a little more after these pictures, but this field was, Jay Fear said it was one of their poorer fields, their poorest field actually, and it's been in a perennial break now for I think just 2 years is what they said, integrating livestock on it. It's truly incredible the power that roots have, combined with well-managed grazing. Like I said, it was just an outstanding field to look at and a great example of perennial breaks.
Well, it just means that there's not very little So, but we look at things like structure. We have color codes that we go by, three values and chromas of 3-3 or darker still puts it into a mollisol. So this is a deep and dark mollisol. This is your A horizon. This is your first B horizon. You can see there's another thin B horizon here. And so this would be like a BW1 and a BW2. Now right here, you can see that lighter color. So and a lot of the soils here in North Dakota have calcium carbonate in them because the glacier carried limestone material from Canada and it all got deposited in here, and the limestone is the where the calcium carbonate kind of originally formed from. So you can see here right above that layer, no reaction. Right there, I got the reaction. So, oops. So that's, in soils terms, this is a BW, which means it's kind of weathered in place. But here where we have an accumulation of that calcium carbonate, we call those BK horizons.
When you get in, like you would anyway.
In a goofy-ass location.
Oh, yeah. Four times when they're watching you. Yeah, right. When you're by yourself, first boom. Time. First time. Every perfect. Time. Get on. Like,
really? Nobody was around to see that? Come on. Proud of myself.
Thank you much.
Absolutely. You say, but the home is kind of gone, and when you get out into the landscape, they used to be in our tree rows and such, but the tree rows kind of are disappearing off the landscape. So the idea is to have a raise in the center. Okay, so you have a raised area. And then we took five native grasses, bunch grasses, five native, big blue, little blue, switch, Indian, one other I'm not thinking of, cider. And then we took five native forbs. And then the forbs are for the future pollinators, like this purple prairie clover. And the clump grasses, the beetles use them for their home and overwintering. And life cycles occur in that sward. And so you want to raise, because then in the spring, in our environment, when it thaws, it would fill their cavities and cleans out a lot of them. So you have just a little raise in it. And then the urban conservationists took these same plugs. These were plugs out of Watertown.
Okay.
Big Sioux Nursery grows them. And so our urban conservationists had them available when we had our hand plant day. Okay, so people come for hand plant trees. And then we had these available, and we called it a beetle bump. So you go to your backyard, and you take 3, 4, 5 of these, and you put them in a little circle of life, if you will, and nice little design or irregular shape. And then it can be something similar to what this can be. So this is our attempt.
And the purpose for the beetles?
They're predatory, so like, we'll give you an example. Slugs, they're one of the big predators. Slugs. Okay, but the habitat is not used that far. Or even in the drop. So all that, so we shouldn't have stopped.
I know.